Today, I'm Norman Wildberger. This is the fourth of a series on foundations of mathematics, and we're going to talk about subtraction and division today. So far what we've done is we've established the fundamental objects in mathematics, the natural numbers. And for us, we have a very simplified way of thinking about those. Those are just strings of ones. So here's 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, and so on. We have two operations, addition and multiplication, which are defined in terms of these strings of ones in a pretty simple and natural way. Already with this framework, we can ask many interesting questions, and we can develop quite a lot of a subject called number theory. So let's just do a little bit of that because it will have some bearing on what comes afterwards. So a few definitions. Suppose that we have three numbers, k, m, and n, and k times m equals n. I'll remind you that means that n is k groups of m. K groups of m. In such a case, we say that k and m are factors of n. These are factors of n. Another definition, if n is equal to m times m, first of all, we introduce the notation m squared for that, so m squared just means m times m. And then we say that the number n is a square. So 1 is a square, 4 is a square, and the next square is 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, since we don't have a name for 9 yet. Next, n is a prime if its only factors are 1, and n itself. We purposely exclude 1 from being a prime, so 1 is not a prime. Here are our list of the first few primes. There's 2, there's 3, there's 5, and then there's another number called 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, and then a few more. Here on the other side we have composite numbers, numbers which are not prime, so 4 is equal to 2 times 2, so it has factors 2. Here is 6 equals 2 times 3, and then a few more. With prime numbers and composite numbers. And we can talk about questions involving prime numbers, for example, twin primes. We can formulate that even with this very elementary framework. Now let's go on to subtraction and division. Subtraction and division are inverse operations to our basic operations of addition and multiplication. The easiest one is subtraction, so let's do that one first. We define subtraction in terms of addition. If k plus m equals n, then we say that k is equal to n minus n. What that means is, here we've got k ones, and we're adding m ones to get n ones. That means that if we take n ones and we take away m ones, we get k ones. So this process of taking away is the opposite of adding on, and that's what subtraction means. So for example, 5 minus 3 is 2 because we take 5, and we take away 3, these 3 here, and we get 2. Or we could say that 5 is equal to 2 plus 3, so 5 minus 3 is equal to 2. And here's another example with numbers whose names we don't have, but 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, minus 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, what is that? Well, we have to take this number and we have to subtract 1's for these. So there's 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. So we have to subtract all of those 1's, leaving us with these 3 1's. It's important to note that n minus m is only defined if n is bigger than m. If n is equal to m or n is less than m, then it's not defined. You might say, well, can't we subtract 4 from 4? Well, we could naively, but we don't have a name yet for a zero. So we would just get nothing and we don't have a symbol for that, so we prefer not to consider that case yet. So only if n is bigger than m can we define n minus m. All right, so the laws of subtraction, they are the following ones, and they're analogous but somewhat different to associative laws for addition and distributive laws for addition. So the first one is n minus m plus k quantity equals n minus m minus k. All these operations are binary. They only take two at a time. So we always have to do two operations at a time. N plus m minus k equals n plus m
minus k. And perhaps the trickiest one, n minus m minus k equals n minus m plus k. Let's illustrate that one with an example. So 5 minus 4 minus 1. Well, 4 minus 1 is 3, so 5 minus 3 should be 2. And indeed, if we take 5 minus 4 and add 1, we get 1 plus 1, that is 2. Then two distributive laws, n times m minus k equals n times m minus n times k. We use the same convention as for addition, namely the multiplication here takes priority over the minus the negative. And the other one, n minus m times k equals n times k minus m times k. And the proofs or the reasons for these laws are very much in the same spirit as the laws for addition that, and multiplication that we've already looked at in previous videos. So I think I will leave that to you. It's not really anything particularly new about the proofs to these. Now let's have a look at division. Division is the hardest of the four main operations to understand. It is the inverse operation to multiplication. So the definition is this. If k times m equals n, then we say that k equals n divided by m. And we'll use this notation, n divided by m. So for example, 2 times 3 is this. That means two groups of 3. There's one group of 3, there's another group of 3. This number is 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. All right, so inverting that, it means that if we take this number and ask how many groups of 3 are in it, the answer is 2. So this number, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, divided by 3 is 2. It's telling us that the number of groups of 3 in here is 2. Note, n over m is only defined if m is a factor of n. We require that m be a factor of n so that we can write n as k times m. Otherwise, this division is, at this point, not allowed. We want the result of a division to be another natural number. So we are not working in the realm of fractions yet. That's considerably more advanced. We're just sticking with natural numbers. It's a very important point. Okay, so division has some rules. K over m plus n over m equals k plus n over m. Simple identity rule, n divided by 1 is n. Here, n times k divided by m times k, that's the same as n divided by m. If we have two of these, n divided by m, and we multiply by k divided by l, so we're thinking of this as being an entity and this as being an entity, and we're multiplying these two natural numbers, then that's the same as n times k divided by m times l. And over here, perhaps the most complicated one, n divided by m, that's a natural number. If we divide that by another division, k divided by l, so this natural number divided by this natural number, that's equal to n times l divided by m times k. One point about these relations, we said that division was only defined in case the denominator here is a factor of the numerator. So in all these formulas, we assume that the meaning is if both sides of the formula make sense, in other words, are well defined, then the two sides are equal. We don't claim that if one side is equal, if one side is well defined, then the other side is well defined. These laws need some discussion, and we are going to talk about them and why they are true, and it's really an important and difficult aspect of sort of primary school mathematics to understand these laws. But in the next video, I want to do something a little bit different. I want to discuss the implications of what we've done so far for primary school education. Okay, so we're going to talk about what this approach can tell us about how we should be teaching children basic mathematics. I hope you'll join me for that. I'm Norman Wildberger. Thanks for listening.